Without further ado, I want to hand out the webinar to Ashley Garcia, who is our graduate student assistant at the Institute. And I consider that those who are behind the scenes need to be open to everyone in terms of being part of this community of knowledge. And so we've decided that either Courtney or Ashley will present to all the speakers before we jump into the discussion. And so the mechanics of the discussion is essentially each one of the panelists has 3 minutes, 3 to 5 minutes to introduce their ideas in the essays, and then we'll open up the discussion with Nancy, Rose Hunt, myself, and the public. So Ashley, take over.
Okay, thank you. Hi everyone, welcome to the Institute's first event of the year, which is co-sponsored by the Center for European Studies. As Dr. Cañizares said, my name is Ashley Garcia, and I am the graduate research assistant for the Institute this year. So today's event is Faith in Science from the Boxer Rebellion to COVID-19. This virtual roundtable discussion reflects on science's belief and vice versa, using insights from the anthropology of belief, sociology, the history of knowledge, to arrive at current dilemmas on the politicization of the science of COVID. So today's discussants include Dr. Crosson, Dr. McEnroe, Dr. Palmie, Dr. Hunt, and Dr. Cañizares, who will moderate our discussion today. So Dr. Cañizares will call for audience questions around 1. So for those of us joining today, please feel free to submit questions via the Q&A box and let us know if you'd like to come on screen to ask your question. So I'm going to quickly introduce our participants today in the order that they will be participating. Our first participant is Dr. Brent Crosson. He's an anthropologist of religion and secularism who works in the Caribbean and Latin America. His research has focused on contestations over the limits of legal power, science, and religion in the Americas. His first book is Experiments with Power, Obeah and the Remaking of Religion, which is the winner of the 2021 Clifford Geertz Prize. His research on Caribbean practices of healing and legal intervention has been published in a number of journals, including Method in Theory and the Study of Religion, Ethnos, the Journal of Africana Religions, and Cosmologics. His special issue in the Journal of Ethnos, called What Possessed You, explores the relationship between spirit possession, material possessions, and conceptions of the self. His work on race relations and solidarity has appeared in Anthropological Quarterly and the Duke University Press Journal, Small Axe. His current research focuses on climate change, religion, and conceptions of energy, with chapters on these issues forthcoming in the edited volumes, Mediality on Trial, Climate Politics and the Power of Religion, and Critical Approaches to Science and Religion. Next will be Dr. Sean McEnroe, who's a professor of history at Southern Oregon University, specializing in comparative colonial studies, religion, and state formation. He received his PhD from UC Berkeley and is the author of From Colony to Nationhood in Mexico and A Troubled Marriage, Indigenous Elites of the Colonial Americas. He is a contributor to Borderlands of the Iberian World and Imagining Histories of Colonial Latin America, and a past contributing editor to the Handbook of Latin American Studies and Oxford Bibliographies Online. His articles appear in Ethnohistory, The Americas, the Journal of Colonialism and Colonial Studies, and the Oregon Historical Quarterly. His current book project explores the circulation of ideas about empiricism and spiritual forces among English and Spanish-speaking intellectual communities in the 19th and 20th centuries. Dr. Stephan Palmie is the Norma and Edna Freeling Professor of Anthropology and of Social Sciences in the College at the University of Chicago. He conducts ethnographic and historical research on Afro-Caribbean cultures with an emphasis on Afro-Cuban religious formations and their relations to the history and cultures of a wider Atlantic world. His other interests include practices of historical representation and knowledge production, systems of slavery and unfree labor, constructions of race and ethnicity, conceptions of embodiment and moral personhood, and the anthropology of food and cuisine. He is the author of Wizards and Scientists, Explorations in Afro-Cuban Modernity and Tradition, of Das Elixirgatter, and The Cooking of History, How Not to Study Afro-Cuban Religion, as well as the editor of several volumes on Caribbean and Afro-Atlantic anthropology and history. He is currently completing a book entitled Thinking with Ngangas, What Afro-Cuban Ritual Can Tell Us About Western Scientific Practice and Vice Versa. And lastly, we have Nancy Rose Hunt, who's been a professor of history and African studies at the University of Florida since 2016. After 19 years of teaching history, historiography, and within the joint PhD program of history and anthropology at the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor. She is a medical and cultural historian of Central Africa, now working on psychiatry and madness in Bukavu, the Great Lakes region, and beyond. Edited or co-edited volumes are forthcoming on the history of psychiatry in Africa, the Kinshasa zine artist Papa Mufoko Itu, a colonial lexicon and a nervous state, differently bring together religion and science, and also challenge this polarity through what might be glossed as vernacular forms of knowledge and therapeutic insurgencies. She and Dr. Mbembe coordinate the Theory Informs book series at Duke University. Okay, Dr. Cañizares, I'll give it back to you. Get us started.
Thank you very much, Ashley. That was very thorough. We have indeed four very, very prominent scholars in front of us who will be discussing their own work and each other's work. And so this is the mechanics for today. Each one of you, Brent, Stephan, Sean, will have about 3 minutes, three and a half, four, if you are bold. And don't want to be cut off by me. And then Nancy will kind of engage in discussion of your works from the perspective of her expertise and the topics you yourselves have brought up. And then we'll open up these for a conversation among we guys who are here in the panel and the audience. So without further ado, I would like Stephan to begin, then Brent, and then Sean. And finally, Nancy will kind of take over. So, Stephan.
Okay, well, thanks again for inviting me to this event. I'm sure it'll be a lively discussion. And yeah, I'll just make it, try to make it very brief. In my paper, after, opening with a discussion of the belated parting of ways of science and religion in the 19th century, I begin with an episode known as the Great Cholera Controversy between 1883 and 1885, which features the young prodigy of a, at that point, new microbial vitalism, Robert Koch, and the at that point, a former famous hygienist, Rudolf Pettenkofer, who in a last ditch effort to disprove Koch's bacterial theory of the cause of cholera, drank a vial with Vibrium cholera in front of an audience of students and survived as a denizen of a world in which bacteria existed, but were not necessarily connected to the disease known at that point as cholera. From there, I moved through early essay by almost virtually contemporaneous essay by one of the first British anthropological field workers, Arthur M. Hocart, about calling for what we today would term a robust sociology of knowledge when it comes to A, Fijian ghosts, and B, European belief in contagion, microbial contagion at that point. The next step in my argument is calling for some help from the brilliant Polish physician, Ludwig Fleck, who in a book called The Origin and the Genesis and Development of a Scientific Fact, looked at the long history of medical, theological, other worries about syphilis, and concluded in a book that was published in 1935, but not really read until it was published in English in 1981, that basically science is an eminently, as Durkheim already said, eminently social thing. And with that in mind, I finally look at our current engagement, of course, involuntary with the COVID virus, and make the point that just as in these other cases, COVID ultimately forces us to take science on faith, which doesn't mean that we have propositional beliefs, you know, laymen, that is, laywomen have propositional beliefs in science. You know, I don't believe in the COVID vaccine, I just am glad that I got it. But fact of the matter is that, you know, nature as, you know, popular views of science have it, is not unchanging, but actually transforms, because what humans live in is not an unmediated nature, but what Marx would have called a second nature, in which humans interfere all the time, in which therefore changes in front of our eyes. So this in a nutshell is probably what I should stop.
Oh, thank you, Stephan. Brian, your turn.
Hey, I am Brent. Hello, sometimes I get called Brian. I usually don't correct people, but I guess since I'm speaking, I'll try to keep that. Well, I'll try to keep this short. I was kind of planning on 10 minutes. I read an email that said that, but I understand we have shorter, which is better anyway. I'm just kind of riffing off of my paper, but since this is more about COVID-19, I'm going to talk more about that and try to relate my paper, which is about Obia and the Caribbean, to that. So how to evade responsibility. And I put a little shot at the Backward University of Texas, the J. Hart Sellout and Craig Abbott Memorial Campus. They just changed the name. I hope they change it back to the former name, although I don't think they'll do that without a fight, which is kind of the theme of my talk. How not to evade responsibility? Well, I guess I am trying to say that obia, which is a criminalized term for problem-solving spiritual practices, identified as African in the Anglophone Caribbean, it's been equated with the word science. And so science and obia are synonyms in some contexts in the Anglophone Caribbean. However, I'm saying that this equation of obia and science does not obey the two polarities of our current debate on science, which is often defined, as is this event, in terms of belief in science. And there's been many critiques of belief about in religion, but basically to sketch out the belief in science debate as I see it taking shape, on one side, there's those who quote unquote believe in science. Science is true. It's not bad, it won't harm you. And the scientists say the vaccine is safe and everybody needs to take it. And on the other side is people who are believe science possibly is not always true and is not safe, and are maybe have some conspiracy theories about that, or just don't want public health regulations that the other side says science wants. So this kind of belief and skepticism in regards to science is often taken as the believers in science and the doubters in science. What I'm saying with the equation of obia and science is that when spiritual workers in the Caribbean equate obia and science, they're neither saying that science is good and true, nor that science is bad and false. They're saying that science is powerful. And to say that science is powerful means that power can be used for harm or for healing. And because science is so powerful, that kind of ambivalence is particularly salient. And so this is an ethics of science's danger or risk, and has more to do with proximity to embodied risk than questions of propositional belief or what's sometimes framed in terms of rationality. And so I think that that's a way not to evade responsibility for power. And then I look at the kind of the ways that so-called Western occultists who weren't who are often trying to be non-Western, you know, here you see Aleister Crowley's The Book of the Law, you know, a lot of Egyptology going on there. These two authors, this is a lesser known one, a kind of theosophist in the late 1800s who had a plantation in Tobago in the Caribbean. Aleister Crowley, also British, emerging out of the Order of the Golden Dawn, they both kind of use obeah, but they take it up in a kind of scientistic way, scientism being this celebratory notion of science. Science is true, science is universal, and we can have occult scientism. And so, you know, Aleister Crowley says there is a universal magic. The theosophists say there is a universal spirituality, and they align this with various non-Western practices. This, I'm saying, is not what spiritual workers are necessarily, although they can invoke this as well to legitimize. This is not what spiritual workers are saying. They're talking about the power that science has, the ambivalence of power, and that's that means ethical questions. And I'm saying, I guess, more broadly, that we live in a world defined by different forms of liberalism, and I don't mean liberal in terms of Democratic Party, but as a broader ideology that masks power through fictions of freedom. And so I think in the podcast, there was one point at which we came up with two alternatives. One of them was, you know, we need to have more rational discussions about COVID-19 and science. And then the other one was, I think Jorge said, you know, a strong muscular state. I think he was putting, you know, words into my mouth, but that was the other option. But I'm saying that we live in a world where we kind of want to mask power. And I don't think either of those options is really tenable, because we already live in a strong muscular state. It's just that we don't realize it because we've been brainwashed, myself included. This is the spectrum of two kinds of liberalism. I'll go this quickly. I'm not going to read it. Neoclassical liberalism, that's what we call the right in the US. Neo-social liberalism, that's what we call the Democratic Party, the mainstream Democratic Party. This is coming out of, you know, classical liberalism, slash neoliberalism, kind of like quasi-libertarian too. We're against socialism, social liberalism. And this merges out of a kind of dissatisfaction with social liberalism, in fact. And they're against the government, narrowly defined as social welfare programs, corporate taxes, and regulation, which makes this camp's opposition to public health regulations entirely rational in Evans Pritchard's sense of being entirely consistent with this whole program. And there's nothing irrational about them opposing mask mandates. This is precisely because what matters more is the quote unquote free market. It doesn't matter that some people have to die. What matters more is this ideology of freedom, which is narrowly limited to the free market. And the free individual is a kind of rational economic actor that has guns and private property and whatever, do whatever they want to. At any rate, we have the social liberals. These are the ones that are supposed to believe in science. So I feel like rationality doesn't get us anywhere. This is a rational position, not just because science has done bad things, but just because, like, they're free market neoliberals. I mean, what do you expect from them? I don't think it really gets us anywhere. We need to talk about the kind of ethics of power that's involved here. And I use the example of this Liberty Institute that's being proposed at UT, which is all about quote unquote limited government, but represents a direct government intervention by conservative legislatures, the governor and the lieutenant governor, in the public university system to impose their own ideology. And so you get these ideas of freedom, limited government, that coincide with a certain kind of extreme authoritarianism. And so I think that's what we need to get out of. We need to realize we already live in a strong muscular state that's authoritarian. It has a certain kind of authoritarianism that might be different than other places. You know, this is a kind of more center liberal evasion, which is tied to the rule of law, which was invoked by a lawyer to try to say, you shouldn't be protesting after the police killed your loved ones. You know, justice is not in the road. And he's performing a ritual that was called obia. He could have said, religion isn't in the road. Obia is in the road, but real religion is in a church. Justice is not in the road. Justice is in the hall of justice. This is a more center liberal evasion based in proceduralism and the rule of law. So these are two kinds of evasions. This one, the kind of a more, I guess you could say, muscular authoritarianism. This one kind of like, just follow the rules. All right, so I'm not gonna read all these. We don't need a muscular state because we already live in one. We live in a constant state of war, even though the US tries to attempt to export it. And then when there's a war, it's like, oh, let's just get away from power. Like they're not, you know, the Afghan government isn't doing the right thing, even though that's some kind of sham democracy we set up as a puppet. You know, like, oh, we're just gonna wash our hands and get out of there. Like that's like, again, fleeing from power, which is fleeing from responsibility. This is ingrained in our liberal rhetoric. This is the only thing that allows us to basically project images of authoritarianism onto other countries and have these recycled media tropes of dictatorships in Latin America, in Asia, in Africa, that are replay colonial logics. And I'm not here to discuss the merits of the Venezuelan government or not, but I'm saying that these kinds of representations are what allows this kind of evasion of power and responsibility to happen. And I think that also the United States, again, needs to take responsibility for the situation in Venezuela, because they're imposing unilateral sanctions that have a lot to do with the situation there. And the focus shouldn't be on blaming the other government, blaming the Afghan government didn't do it right. It's their fault. You know, this leads to blaming, just blaming without taking responsibility. And I think that's the situation we're in. It doesn't really have to do much with who's rational and who's not.
Thank you, Brent. Sorry for me mispronouncing your name. I've been known for calling my son Limon instead of Nicolas. The next participant in the workshop is Sean. So Sean, please, your turn.
Good, thank you, Jorge. And by the way, thanks to everyone who helped me get here to UT. I hadn't been off my campus for a long time, and I'm working right now in the Benson Collection, which is a minor miracle. For those of you who read the paper, your first reaction may have been that it was a fairly disparate set of topics and that the author was recklessly wandering through territory that he's not in a good position to comment on. And so if that's your reaction, it was fair. I wanna, in this couple of minutes at the beginning, bring some coherence to the project. And then for people who haven't had a chance to read the paper, I just want to give you a quick sense of what the range of cases is that I consider in it and how it relates to this discussion about magic and medicine and science. So generally speaking right now, I'm engaged in the same kind of question that Brent was just talking about. The question of when debates about science and magic are about the efficacy or truth of something, and when the debates are about the moral value or goodness of something. And in general, my conclusion is that for a very long time, more people have simultaneously embraced magical thinking and empiricism at the same time than we're comfortable acknowledging. And I have tried to walk back this story a little bit into the late 19th century. The cases in my paper are very diffuse geographically, but they're very concentrated in time. So all of the events take place between 1890 and 1910. And the cases under consideration are the Ghost Dance movement in North America, the Boxer Rebellion in China, and the Maji Maji Rebellion in what was then German East Africa and is now Tanzania. And then I wrap up by talking about the Mexican Revolution and Francisco Madero, which relates closely to my research right now in the Benson Collection. The comparison is occasioned by a coincidence that occurred to me while teaching, that I found really puzzling. how can it be that at about the same time, all over the world, groups of people who had never directly encountered each other, who were engaged in anti-colonial wars, simultaneously came up with these magical practices that look very similar to anthropologists that allow them to fend off bullets and defend themselves against modern weapons? So in North America, ghost dancers believed that these shirts that they constructed and consecrated in various ways could make them immune to bullets. In German East Africa, a lot of people came to believe that either ingesting or anointing oneself with a magical water could protect them from German firearms. And in the Boxer Rebellion in China, people engaged in a variety of different martial arts and meditative practices that they thought would repel bullets from the government or from the British. Interesting coincidence. So on one hand, it seems like a very logical reaction to a sense of helplessness against new and unfamiliar technologies. On the other hand, the technologies were perhaps less new and less unfamiliar than one might suppose. So these Boxer rebels are not people from the remote jungles of the Amazon. They've had routine exposure to firearms and modern weaponry for some time. And many of these people are people who lived through the era of the Taiping Rebellion. So they're fully immersed in a world of modern war. Likewise, in East Africa, a lot of the people involved in the Maji-Maji revolt are people who are carrying firearms, albeit more primitive firearms than the ones used by the Germans. And the Boxers actually are maybe the most outstanding case. The ghost dancers, the North American ghost dancers often were people who had fought in the Sioux Wars. So they had experienced war against the central government of the United States, but actually a good number of ghost dancers were also performers in Wild West shows. So they'd traveled to big cities on the East Coast of the United States, and some of them had traveled to Europe. So they knew a great deal about modern industrial technology and warfare. Puzzling. So I like to flip the question around then and consider not just what the ghost dancers and the Boxers and the Maji-Maji rebels think about European technology, but also how the Europeans represent them and represent themselves at the time of these rebellions. So as you might predict, the European and American press sometimes reports on these phenomena as irrational and primitive in character. And yet occasionally we get the sense of misgiving in observers from Anglo-European society, this sense of fear that perhaps foreign magic might be real. And there are a lot of reasons why that would be the case. So in the years preceding and concurrent with these events, some of the biggest social phenomena in North America and Europe were things like mesmeric healing and theosophy and channeling and psychic research and the healing of Christian Science. So actually there was not a sharp distinction in the empirical qualities of the things that many Europeans were doing and the things that these rebelling colonial peoples were doing or colonized peoples were doing at the same time. Setting that aside for a moment, I want to explain why it is that I'm here at UT and why I'm digging around in the Benson collection. I'm digging around in there because, to me, Francisco Madero, the one of the leading figures in the Mexican Revolution and one-time president of Mexico, typifies this strange ambivalence toward modernity, science, and magic. So in 1910, Francisco Madero triggered the Mexican Revolution by publishing a short book that argued against the regime of Porfirio Diaz. And then he marshaled all kinds of fairly disparate political forces together into a viable political campaign, was expelled from Mexico, took shelter briefly here in Texas before crossing the border back into Mexico again and prevailing in his struggle against the previous government of Mexico. And if you read like a school kid's textbook version of this revolution in Mexico today, he figures as a modernizer, a republican, a rationalist, an industrialist, and he was all of those things. He was a businessman, he was a modern person, He was highly educated in Mexico. He also attended Berkeley, my alma mater. He knew the world very, very well. And yet, the whole time that Madero was waging this revolution, one of his key advisors was his dead brother, Raul, who he was contacting through various kinds of spiritualism. So in the person of Madero, a lot of these paradoxes are concentrated for me. It was tantalizing when the folks here at the Benson discovered that they had a new collection of materials from an organization called the School of Magnetic Spiritualism. It's an organization that began in Argentina, existed all over Latin America, and to my surprise, existed in Texas until the, well, until the present. And that organization shared many beliefs with Madero. Its location here was in San Antonio. I'd like to know if there was a closer connection than I can yet verify. And the beliefs of that organization combined all kinds of scientific study of things like electricity and physics with mediumship and contacting the dead. So this is a scattered project. It's heading toward a book in the future. It's in pieces. And so I will be really grateful to the other panelists, but also the people in the audience who have greater expertise in these individual cases than I do and have suggestions to make. Thank you.
Thank you, Sean. Thanks. Now, Nancy, you are the commentator. So your turn. Thanks.
I think you're muted, Nancy.
Okay, sorry. I was saying thank you very much. Thanks for this invitation. Sorry I couldn't join you for the podcast. I only managed to listen to 10 minutes this morning, so I'm a bit out of date. But I immensely enjoyed these papers and how they intersect with each other. And what I have to offer to you is kind of scribbled up paper. And it's probably not going to do justice to any of the papers, but hopefully it'll take us somewhere interesting. Okay, Stephan Palmier's essay is a wonderful piece by a brilliant stylist that helps us understand the Fauci versus Trump polarity on science through a deeply historical take on epidemics, medical science, and the history of anthropological and SDS theory. The parts that I liked the best was how he worked with Hokar and with Fleck and the vocabulary that he pulled out there and signaled for us as important. And that was from Hokar, the social nature of any knowledge of reality, which Fleck turns into the social nature of facts and facticity. But Fleck also speaks about thought styles and thought collectives, which in a way goes very well with the PowerPoint that Brent just gave us, the polarities that he had going there. You know, this is you're on to sort of an ethnographic reading in a sense, Brent, of what those two thought collectives are, and more work could be done in that direction. The other two papers, so here comes a scam phone call. Let me get rid of that. Are more laden than I would like with three words: science, religion, belief. In the podcast of the other day, Stephan rehearsed for us why it's so important to hesitate before the word belief, why it's important to even just eliminate it from the way we write. This is something I learned from Adam Ashforth, who's a big specialist on witchcraft in Africa during my years at Michigan, where he took very eloquently graduate students to task why it was important to get the word belief out of their papers and how to think about other vocabularies. I remember the effect on my own text of sort of lightening away that weighty thing-like word and moving more and more, I was on a Bourdieu track then, towards the word practice, towards what were people doing and when. regardless, practice cannot stand alone, but knowledge with practice, to my mind, are a great way of moving beyond and effacing the two polarities that come out in the papers and the discussions of the other day, science versus tradition or science versus religion. But it should also be said that my way of looking at many of the issues in these papers comes very much from a particular Africanist prism. The stuff that I'm most focused on is Maji Maji in Tanzania, which I've taught for 30 years. I've almost always had an undergraduate class. I always throw Maji Maji in. It's always great to teach. The history of scientific research and medicine in Africa, trypanosomiasis, cholera, positive eugenics, which was my first book, STDs, AIDS, Ebola, all of that is material that historians of medicine and science have worked over. And more recently for me, Obia, which is something that I met Brent on, Leah Rosenberg set up a little phone call with us just when COVID was breaking out, and we talked about his recent book on Obia. I've started I now do a more Atlantic history book that's a course that's about madness and blackness. And I have at least a full week on Obia. And I teach this as a phenomenon linked up with rebellions, slave and post-slave rebellions, and always fraught contradictory perceptions of madness. But to go back to that Africanist prism, I am talking about the minds that came together in the 1970s to destabilize kind of biological histories of medicine on the continent. And this was people like Steve Fireman, John Jansen, Murray Last, later Megan Vaughn, later again, Stacy Caldwell, Julie Livingston, later again, Wenzel Geisler, and Guillaume Lachenal. Whatever you want to call that school, and it's morphed in many ways, it's become much more STS over time. It's often still called the School of Health and Healing Studies in Africa. So religion is in there, belief is in there, science is in there, magic is in there. But the framing is always coming back to kind of healing as a practice, whether it's wherever it is, whether it's happening in a deep in a forest somewhere or in a modern hospital. Although there are many variants here among these scholars and their students, all have privileged healing and therapeutic economies first as blendings of scientific and religious practices involving technologies and things, systems and non-systems, that's Marie Last, knowledge and sociality, sometimes guns, usually fetishes, but they're called consecrated charms, and sometimes, as in my case, obstetric forceps, birth certificates, bicycles, so things that were embedded in healing and medical context. One can even say that the material turn came to sub-Saharan Africa very early, before Latour and STS hit, and through this kind of practice, tracking of practice and objects. Now to go to Obia, I was first drawn to Obia as I grappled with how to interpret evidence in my own work on Congolese healers who used objects, who used consecrated charms or fetishes to ignite protests, fires, tax rebellions, and other kinds of furies, all empowered by human-made medicines. At the same time, I was pushing to a new degree John Jansen's pointing to the ambivalence of all Central African medicines, and thus the distinction between medicines that heal and medicines that harm. These medicine-based rebellions of my histories, most of them are gathered in my book, A Nervous State, aimed on the one hand to protect familiars and insiders as if aggressed in war, as if aggressed in a pre-colonial war, but now they were up against colonial forces and colonial violations. And on the other hand, to attack and eliminate the white man, to literally mow them down and kill them in various forms. So increasingly, and in that book, I call these rebellions therapeutic insurgencies to emphasize the healing and harming material inside what was going on there. And I began teaching obia in the same way, on a basis of a slender set of primary documents that I was able to kind of assemble overnight quickly without, you know, probably doing all the contextual reading I should have done. And, I was also becoming increasingly a historian of madness and with all the capaciousness that that term applies. And so I was slotting obia into this course as one set of incidents in a post-middle passage, convergences in blackness and madness. And my students and I found rich evidence there, mostly around terror as madness and the use of terror to infuriate and drive the other crazy, to drive them wild or insane or mad. And that was usually the white man. Hurling obia as an insult or a form of condemnation was not rare, it seemed to me. And mixed in there, one could find languages of madness. Of course, history has also shown many times over that racism is a form of madness, or racism yields madness. And you do not need to wait until Frantz Fanon to find this strain of thought. This thought about psychopathology. My hunch is that in the massive amounts of obia evidence lies much more material about these edges that I'm getting at that could be teased out more. But just like obia had moments as dizzying, turbulent, agitated therapeutic insurgencies with a nervous state or a madness running through its core tonalities, something similar may be narrated on the basis of the thorny maji-maji evidence with its complex mediations of collecting memory work in early post-colonial Tanzania under Nyerere. So I was saying to Sean earlier, I think there's just a book waiting to be done about what that whole collecting project was, how it was done, how Nyerere was involved, how ILIF was negotiating that terrain, how he was competing with Terrence Ranger, what was going on, and then, you know, in fact, who did the translation, what that evidence suggested. So it certainly needs a very careful interpretation. But there's no question in my mind, Maji Maji was a therapeutic insurgency. That's how I teach it. And that's how I've always read it. But it moved in multiple directions. The question about it's how far it moved and its spread. Nyerere needed Maji Maji to go far. He was trying to prove the point that this was a pan-ethnic movement. And so your stretch for it is much farther than I had ever understood it went. I thought it was definitely regional. But missing in the paper, it seems to me, is the material basis in the originating locality, where I think it was cotton workers who were cruelly overworked on German plantations by very specific German plantation owners with their coastal Swahili overseers. You have dynamics there that come out of the oral testimony that I've seen that makes it clear that it begins with a very materialist, not at all a magical orientation. But once the insurgency got going, there were these healers, there was this special water, there were consecrated medicines that all came into play until the story shifted scales, perhaps to the German colonial army then coming in with its machine guns. So I think it's wonderful you're doing it. I think it's a wonderful project to compare these three things. I think you maybe need to get it down to three instead of five. So it's like kind of manageable for an article, unless it's gonna be a book. But I think there's definitely more to be done on the Tanzanian stuff. And the other piece to look at is Zimmerman. Andrew Zimmerman did a really famous, wonderful piece in comparative studies in science and history. A German anthropologist came in just at the time of Maji Maji, and he collected drawings. And those drawings give you a parallel kind of evidence to work with in terms of what people were undergoing at that time. So now I want to shift gears just a little bit and say that I think Black Lives Matter was America's recent long rambunctious therapeutic insurgency. People sought better lives. They were seeking healing. They were seeking escape from trauma and healing and suffering. They were seeking an end of racism. And those who marched, those who were spectators, those who were journalists, spoke left and right in different kinds of languages all the way up to the White House, but language of madness permeated what was going on there, or perceptions and accusations. And the movement took on an aura, it's thus in many ways of madness, but differently perceived. And through, again, you could go back to Stefan's language of these different thought collectives, how Black Lives Matter was understood. Of course, if it was madness in many people's eyes, in others, it was also of profound rationality and of overdue claims and the like. So madness certainly cannot do everything for us, but by keeping one interpretive eye glued on its appearances and resonances, one can note when it gets pulled into a scientific psychiatric register on the one hand, and when it may be pushed, or when it was part of more of a religious prophetic register of visions, hallucinations, deliria of the kind found in the therapeutic insurgencies of Maji Maji and Obia. And then my simpler point is just to go back to that notion of it's good to walk away from those easily reifying boxes of religion, science, tradition, belief. I don't think they help us in our work. And that's what I have for you guys. That's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Nancy. That was brilliant. Thank you. Now we begin our conversation and our the Q&A, and I have been the guy who is coordinating this. I have a couple of questions. It seems to me like the entire field is organized around these polarities that Nancy referred to, science versus magic, or science versus religion, or belief versus doubt, et cetera, et cetera. And so we are moving in different directions. I think Brent suggested that in the podcast, the issue of power, who gets to define what, whose rationality matters, who is mad, or who is reasonable, in the language of Nancy's language. I think one of the great things that I got out of Stefan's paper is two things. First of all, is the element that social constructionist ideas or sociologies of knowledge are beginning already in the late 19th century. This is not a thing of Foucault or what is the name of the historian of science whose name is escaping me, Kuhn, but go back to the late 19th century. And the other element that is interesting about it is that if we really believe in the social construction of knowledge, whatever that is, and we believe in Marx's notion of second nature, then the social construction of knowledge is transforming nature at the same time that nature transform creates these contingencies, these unplanned things, like COVID, these things that escape control. And so second nature seems to be a very interesting addition to our understanding of these polarities, namely the cunning of science, the fact that we have no control over what we ourselves create through social construction. So I don't know whether Stefan wants to elaborate on this a little bit more.
Sure, I'd be happy to. Well, as you pointed out, Jorge, we, you know, if you go back to Durkheim or Gumplevich and, various other Gabriel Taud sociologists around, or even before the turn of the 20th century, as Durkheim says it, and he literally puts science and religion on the same same level by saying that, you know, they are both eminently social things, right? So, and in a sense, you know, if you, you know, if you look at Engels's The Dialectic of Nature, which is, I think, an underappreciated book, although it's, it has its weird moments too. I mean, you will recall that Engels in that book has a chapter where he talks about spiritualism. He attended seances, and as did Tyler, you know, whoever else. I mean, spiritualism, and, you know, maybe I can, you know, I talked about that briefly in the podcast. I think maybe I can just throw that in there, was ultimately the religion to end all religions, in that it based itself on what they perceived as scientific rationality. And so hence it's morphing into, not only did it assimilate all kinds of technologies within no time, I mean, from telegraphy, photography, phonography, and on and on, it also, in a sense, or spiritualists were well aware of the way in which nature, progressivists that they were, is malleable, and nature changes in under the impact of human intervention. I mean, as you know, Marx says, we, you know, are the only animal that does not just live in its environment, but that transforms its environment as it reproduces in it. So, so that said, I think maybe now harking back a little bit to Nancy's wonderful comments. I think the polarity between healing and harming is, you know, ultimately a product of the same kind of, Latour would call it a modernist project of purification, right? Where, where we, aim to keep nature and society apart, or you know, healing and harming, therapy and warfare, and so on and so forth. And what we get is, and this is, you know, Sean's paper shows it beautifully, what we get is hybrids. And not in Bakhtin's sense, intentional hybrids, but organic ones that, you know, sort of go unnoticed unless we apply these distinctions. So, you know, resistance as madness is something, you know, it's a standard trope. I mean, you know, it comes straight out of, you know, imperial, you know, colonialism and imperialism. And I mean, I just thought about, you know, the Carithers report in the context of Mau Mau, where, you know, the a psychiatrist was called in by the British to interview the, you know, a relatively small amount, less than 100, I think, of Mau Mau insurgents, and came up with the idea that the leaders would have to be charged as criminally insane, and the rest of the former combatants would have to be subjected to psychiatric treatment with, I think, indoctrination in Christianity, if I remember that correctly. But that's, you know, it's even the British reaction, you know, psychiatry at that point became a fantastic hybrid of politics and medicine, right? So, and that's something which, you know, I always found, you know, this, of course, Obia fits right in there, as Nancy pointed out, and as Brent today also exemplified, that, you know, it depends upon from, you know, what thought style you apply to these phenomena, right? So, you know, I could give you Cuban examples for just about the same thing, but, you know, that's, you know, that would take us probably too long. And, you know, I've already been taking up a good deal of time. So let's maybe move on to others. And, you know, maybe we can, at a later stage, have a joint discussion.
Well, I have a question for Brent here, and which is, and also for Nancy. Brent rejects the belief doubt science, religion, categories of analysis, and foregrounds, power and responsibility, my question is, in the case of COVID, how to use these tools of analysis to not necessarily predict, but at least guide our own understanding of what is next, what is coming up, and how to solve these. Well, not to solve, but I don't think it's an issue of solving it, but at least understanding what happens and what is likely to happen in the future. So if it is about power and responsibility, and in the case of Nancy, if it is about practice and knowledge as the categories that matter, what to do with these, in the case of Brent, these two different understandings of liberalism, one that he both equally authoritarian in their own way, muscular in the construction of the state, but also very difficult to see as such, as muscular, but the opposite. So how to solve this conflict that has not allowed us to resolve the issue of the pandemic and COVID and so on and so forth, that could have been more easily resolved. So this is a question for both Nancy and Brent.
You want to go first, Brent?
Sure, yeah, thanks for that question. Really good question. What to do? Well, I'll start with the science and religion stuff because that's easier. I think it's important to pay attention to the categories and to include magic in there. And I think that's a category that I don't know if we've explicitly brought up as much as science and religion, but that we also sometimes use as if it's a kind of transcultural category or transhistorical category, you know, when probably it would be good to take a step back and see what words people are using, actually. Like, if they're calling it magic, like, I don't know about maji-maji, maybe that comes from the word magic, could be like from Swahili or something. I think it's important to pay attention to those words. And if it's not magic that people are talking about, what is it? I mean, for example, with Obia, one of the key early examples in relation to Taki's rebellion or the Koromanti War was that these accused Obia practitioners gave rebels powder that was supposed to make them protect them, you know, in battle, or make them immune to bullets, I guess. And I've told people this, and some people get mad when I tell them this. They're like, oh, they're fooling them, you know, playing on their superstition, which was the trope of Obia, right? Which is like these Obia men were these, charlatans that were playing on people's superstition. But I just feel like that's just shows the power of categories, because it's probably just boring and banal to say that every soldier in a war like might have done something to bring a little bit of luck. I mean, I don't know, just wear something, necklace, a cross, a saint, whatever. Just doesn't seem like that big of a deal. Just seems like something that probably a lot of people have done. So that's when we kind of, I think taking a step back from like, is when we call something magic, we kind of get hung up on certain ideas about it and kind of exoticizing ideas too. And the other thing that's important to realize is that these terms aren't always separate, they often double for each other. So science and magic have often doubled for each other. Religion and magic can double for each other, you know, and especially in like the anti-religious rhetoric. So, you know, like new atheists or something, where basically all religion is superstition. So. And magic and superstition are also kind of different too, because we have the romantic image of magic and then, you know, superstition, which is kind of the rationalist thing that comes up more in the 1800s, I guess. So at any rate, I think those candidates, it's important to mention that they double for each other. And that's in Durkheim too, where Durkheim separates off magic because it's individualistic and he's a collectivist. And so really, that's also something interesting. So in terms of what to do, I think we have to fight. I mean, I don't see a way around it. I think that I'm personally realizing that I can't be as neutral as I have liked to be. You know, when I'm teaching or when I'm speaking, that I'm mad. You know, so thank you for indulging my expression of madness, but I'm going to, I feel as though part of what I have concluded is that we're in an inherently partisan battlefield, and that I like to be neutral in teaching because I like to students to, you know, think whatever they're going to think, but I'm feeling called to be more explicit and more focused on things that are happening now. I think academic production pushes us to kind of because it's slow to not do that as much. But I think I would like to to shake off the fantasy of neutrality more in my own actions. That's what I can do.
Okay, so I want to do two things. I want to go back to Stefan's point about healing and harming being a purifying language, according to Latour. And I think it depends how you investigate it and you narrate it. If you have an event and it's an insurgency, and you can show you have that hybrid. It's already a hybrid, healing and harming, but it's a healing and harming within a mobile situation where people are, you know, stripping Europeans and using their clothes and doing something with it. And another 20 years later, it's a different kind of hybrid, but it's the same kind of language that it is, I think, a language of war. It's very, very ancient. And African societies that always used medicines to heal and protect. But but that issue of, you know, getting a vibrant text going so that the rendering of these events is very, very important. So much gets lost when you're, you know, in a language of thought, belief, and reason, rather than just like, what were people doing, and trying to interpret the little bits of evidence you have. So, but for the thought, practice and knowledge, I just think it's certainly going on. But we need new ethnographies. If we're talking about American society, we need new ethnographies of American society that are COVID-based. You know, it can be multi-sided, or one person can do it, but someone has to go inside the CDC and understand that thought world and that thought species and what's going on and how are they acting and practicing. And then how does that relate to, you know, those wonderful images that were shown last year about the refrigerators of Trump. If you were a Trump supporter, you had this kind of refrigerator. If you were a Biden supporter, you had this kind of refrigerator. So, you know, it goes obviously into daily life. But then what should be the other zones of the anti-vaxxers, and, you know, how to access those places? But that, to me, is the way to understand how people are articulating things and what they're doing. And it might not change anything, but it would produce a useful kind of knowledge about what's going on in our worlds. It can also do the university. I mean, you could go into the University of Florida tomorrow and start to, you know, I mean, hopefully someone's doing that. You know, it's pretty wild right now what we're dealing with here. So that's my thought.
Well, we have a question by Jade Evans.
Good.
For you, Nancy, do you have any sense that Americans who are choosing not to get vaccinated for various reasons are meeting criteria for what you call madness, quote unquote?
Well, I hear people saying it's madness, you know, so the idiom of it's madness. And, you know, I have a nephew who's a Trump supporter. I heard him over lunch in upstate New York, you know, say to me what things that I think are, you know, it's madness. So you can have battles over what's madness there. But certainly I think, you know, the doctors who are protesting in Miami, they're partly using a language of it's madness.
Okay.
I don't know what's happening in the psychiatric wards. You know, there's probably another whole dimension to the story there in terms of if you read the Lancet, the psychiatric thing, the articles on COVID since this all began, there's just a huge escalation of investigation into people's mental states. So, and there must be some anti-vaxxer pieces out there by now, but the suicide rates, you know, so on all sides, I bet those are ripping on all sides.
Could I add something? I was just thinking about that in our podcast, how we talked about this question of the rationality of anti-vaccine positions. And we mentioned, you know, my friend in California who is like a hippie that doesn't want to get vaccinated. And he brought up the opioid crisis and that, you know, kind of corporate pharmaceutical companies that we've entrusted with quote unquote science. I mean, when we say science, we always mean something specific. And so in this case, you know, that's kind of involved in what we mean, that he doesn't trust them. And that's a rational fear. It's not irrational. I mean, big pharmaceutical companies have done bad things. And just recently, the opioid crisis is one example.
Think that's Stefan's point, is inside these thought collectives, there's always a rationality. It doesn't make sense to use belief. It's to, you know, to try to get inside and understand the logics why this is rational.
Yeah, I think that's where just saying it's rational doesn't get us anywhere. And then I went to like Feyerabend and how he talks about propaganda. I think that's a way that you could like make effective propaganda if you wanted to. Like I was listening to this radio show where they got Chris Christie to like talk to all these anti-vaxxers. And they're like, finally, when Chris Christie talked to them, they're like, oh yeah, you know. But when scientists talk to them, they're like, you know, didn't want to listen to them. So they could like, I don't know, put ads with Chris Christie on Fox News or something. I mean, if you wanted to just be pragmatic about it, it's probably the way to get more of those people.
Well, this is the issue for me, which is this is not going to be solved by persuading rationally anyone, because there are two rationalities pitted against each other. It's not about more powerful reason defeating the other. For me, it's something that has no solution. It's not a problem of dialogue and civil dialogue. And for me, the things to come are worse, because if you look at the census of 2020, you see that white supremacy, it's bound to get even madder in Nancy's, Nancy's terms, or the resistance from this group and the willingness to enact acts of resistance and healing, whatever that is, of their own. If you look at the direction of demography, it's bound to get even worse and more violent, because 2020 compared to 2010, you have a decrease of 3% of percentage of white population overall. You have a lowering of the median age for Hispanics. You have the increase of median age for whites. The other two groups, Asians have also grown. And so what seems to be going to happen is that, I mean, the Supreme Court is going to play a supreme role in making sure that median age of whites lowers down. And so they are going to do something with abortion. The resentment of this population that is by 2030, not going to be the majority of the population anymore. Just by looking at statistics and demography, the future doesn't look very, very appealing, to be honest, if we are leaving the Black Lives Matter and we're leaving the resistance to COVID anti-vaxxers, et cetera, this is just child things to come, in my opinion. I don't know what everybody else has to say. So the issue of power, how to address the issue of power ultimately in this context, because the issue of whose rationality is not going to be settled, and it's never been settled through civil discourse. It's been settled through power and institutional power. And that is what we know from the history of knowledge, the history of sociology of knowledge. What settles the consensus of the power of one of these systems of rationality over the other is institutional power, period.
Well, if I might jump in, I'm thinking about what you just had to say, Jorge, in light of the Nancy's early comments and Stefan's about the social construction of knowledge and how the creation of human communities is related to the conclusions that they draw, whether those conclusions be scientific in character or political in character. And I'm thinking about how often it's the case that the people I point to in my work as fanatics for magic are engaged in institutions that they see as absolutely scientific. And the social qualities of those institutions are very similar to ours, meaning university professors. When I read, actually yesterday I was reading in the archive here, the records from the Spiritist Congresses from Mexico from the beginning of the 20th century. And they read a lot like a meeting of the American Historical Association. It's a group of presenters. They have shared interests. There are panels. Sometimes they've put a premise on the table for debate, and they then pass resolutions at the end once they've decided what the academic consensus is about the community over things like whether a medium is a person with an innate capability or a medium can contact the dead because he or she is trained. So they're doing this. The whole social practice of Spiritism is a lot like our social practice of academic life. And I've also been spending a lot of time in the British archives, and in England around the same time, there are lots of Spiritists and lots of other people interested in scientific phenomena who describe themselves as scientists. They have organizations, they have journals, they have laboratories in which they're testing different kinds of psychic phenomena, tiny medium tables with levitating objects, spirit photography apparatuses in order to capture auras and all of this. And they're superficially engaged in exactly the same things that any person in the physical sciences would be engaged in at the same time. And it's actually not different people. And this is where Stefan's comments about purification of subjects come in. It's actually the same people. In England, the prominent physicists of the time, these people like, you know, Oliver Lodge, are producing groundbreaking research in the physical sciences, and they're engaged in all of this psychic research. So, you know, what's the lesson out of this? Should this make us lose faith in the ability of academic institutions to discern truth? Sometimes, but maybe not, because if you follow those psychic researchers over time, their results keep diminishing. So some of the people stay with it for years and years and years. Some of these psychic research institutions existed into the 1950s, and they had outsized claims to begin with, and then they became more and more and more modest until by the middle of the 20th century, some of the most enthusiastic psychic researchers had reversed their opinion. So in this, I see a little shred of hope for our current debates about science and public health. And I also see a role for the university in this. That is, a university is a place for the production of knowledge and for the vetting of truth. And we should approach it with a sense of humility, given how many ridiculous errors of science have taken place in the past, but also with a sense of optimism that we have something to contribute. And just, I'm going on a little too much, but I will say that on this point, the most inspirational writer for me is Julian Benda, the mid-century French thinker, who argues, makes a surprising argument. He argues that our problem in university is not that we are insufficiently politically engaged, but that we have lost credibility as arbiters of truth between competing political groups. I'm resolving each day to try a little harder to do that in some way.
Before Nancy or anyone else wants to reply to the question, we have a question by Noé Godinez, which kind of echoes my own. It says, I would like to mention that one of my vivid memories of the 2020 spring semester was when Professor Cañizares-Esguerra entered the class and mentioned in a serious tone how the pandemic was coming. At times when things seem so divisive, I tend to wish I could go decades into the future and look back on the issues to see how things played out and try to have fresh eyes. Do any of the presenters or moderators have similar quote unquote thought experiments for COVID or any other issue?
It sounds like you're the one with the prophetic vision, Jorge.
Well, I just give you prophecy to 2030. And in the early spring, I gave them prophecy. We'll have a pandemic and don't get even near me.
Well, maybe maybe I can throw in, let's go to the question, because otherwise, you know, we are already at 1:17. So let's do that. I was going to mention Edwin Arden's conception of prophecy, but that's for another time.
Do you have any answer to the question? I mean, how to, civil discourse is not going to solve anything. So what is next?
I don't know. I think that it probably, I'm just really pessimistic. So I'm usually wrong. I'm not very good at predicting the future. But, you know, like in my mind, I'm like, oh, you know, Donald Trump's going to win the next election. Like this thing with Afghanistan is going to be spun, you know, in a way that would be kind of.
I think the immigration bill might be interesting. Mm-hmm. If it really produces a lot of jobs and you have to get vaxxed to get those jobs and people are, someone like my nephew is able to, you know, get out of one little standard of living up to another, be tempted to take that job. And then, you know, new thought collectives form in those workplaces. And I don't know. But I think the infrastructure bill is a lot of money and it might somehow recreate some of the landscape, some of the diversities and means. That, I mean, a lot of this is just coming from deep, deep, deep economic resentment. So mm-hmm. It might create some opportunities that allow people to, you know, think they can marry and have a home, you know, like yeah. Really basic things.
I mean, let's not forget that, you know, in the 1930s, in the middle of the Great Depression, America had a blossoming fascist movement.
Yes. Yes, yes.
I mean, you know, this is something, you know, maybe I'll bring him up anyway. I mean, Arden says that the prophetic condition is when somebody articulates a language that makes no sense at the point in time, but will shortly become common sense for everybody. Uh-huh. That's the thing, you know, we don't really have that language yet. I mean, you know, Jorge, and to a certain extent, Brent as well, you're talking about irreconcilable discourses and forms of, you know, socially distributed forms of thought, but, you know, contingency is often the name of the game. I mean, what'll be around the next bend in the road is, it's something that, you know, maybe somebody smarter than I or maybe you is already talking about, but we're not paying attention because it hasn't come to pass. So, I mean, otherwise, you know, it's just pessimism or in the same sense that, you know, I talk about faith rather than belief in science, you know, faith in democracy, faith in, you know, human goodness, faith in, I mean, you know, that's an attitude that can easily lead you to despair. I mean, faith in common ethics, mm-hmm. you know, racism as madness. Well, you know, sort of you could, you know, I'm sure there are, well, there certainly are very eloquent racists out there who can, you know, formulate some form of rational discourse, even though we may reject the premises on which this rationality builds. I mean, this is Evans Pritchett's issue, you know, the Asunder reason excellently in their own idiom of thought, but can't get out of it. And his prejudgment of the issue, they're wrong because, you know, the premises of their logic is not scientific. So it's, you know, the image that Wittgenstein has of a hinge around which doubt can turn, but which can never fall into doubt itself. That's the problem. I mean, what are the, you know, hinge propositions are very, very hard to unhinge. And, you know, maybe Jorge, you're right. I mean, it has to be legislated into, you know.
Well, we have two more questions and we are coming to an end of the show, not the program, or the podcast. One is actually exemplifies what we have been talking about, the rationality within each one of these groups that is not about belief or science. It's about the rationalities that each one of them deployed. And he says, or she says, how is it rational to get a vaccine that hasn't completed clinical trials while being aware of the history of corporate pharmaceutical malpractice and possessing reasonable distrust of government agencies? There'll be, exemplifies that narrative of the anti-vaxxers. And you could contrast that narrative to a statistical statistical analysis that shows that it's actually working. So it's scientific. So I think we won't settle this issue just by trying to address the issue of rationality. And in that sense, I want to move on to the next question, which is by Rodrigo Salido. It's a very intriguing idea to get rid of belief as a word when writing at the edges of science and religion, but isn't this word that actually connects them in practice, as Dr. Nancy Rose Hunt suggested? Why get rid of that word and not quote unquote knowing, for instance? Would this distinction shed light on these discussions of madness, rationality, and scientific thought? How would we write without them? He says, I love this Marshall Salins quote, the myriad ethnographic statements of the form, the so and so believe that, typically referring to something Europeans would disbelieve, should actually be written the so and so know that, to cite Poulain. It is the non-believers who believe that the believers believe. Why is anthropology and sometimes history, but Talmudic exegesis by non-believers? Well, that is essentially what we are arguing, Rodrigo, all along. But anybody wants, Nancy, would you like to?
No, I'm sorry, I won't. But it's a nice question, but I think I missed half of it. And so let someone else.
Okay, well, it's why to use the word believe, or why not to use the word believe and use the word knowing? What is the difference?
I mean, I think that, you know, like going back to, I was just teaching, you know, Assad's construction of religion and anthropological category. And I think there's different ways to use the word, belief. And he seems to be critiquing this like propositional belief idea, which I think does tend to reduce things to questions of individual volition or rationality. It's like I choose to believe something, and I think that's a point of critique. This kind of individualizing, rationalizing kind of idea of belief. I think the other question is right, that, you know, it is rational to doubt the vaccine when it hasn't completed. I mean, that's my hippie friend in California. That's his whole thing, right? And he's not going to be convinced by Chris Christie because he thinks Chris Christie is an asshole because, you know, he's not a Republican. So there's all kinds of people that, you know, you wouldn't convince with that. But you can, you know, you could say it's rational, just like believing that, you know, getting the vaccine is rational too, because there have been trials that have been conducted that show that it's safe. But I had a point with that, although I kind of lost my train of thought there. But I think it's like there's different ways to use the word belief. And in teaching Assad's article, this is like a kind of propositional language of belief that I think he's critiquing.
I think when you're inside a religious box and you're learning a creed and there's texts, like if you think of my therapeutic insurgency, if you went 20 miles away, there'd be a Christian mission church. Those people were being taught what to believe, and they were being given the text, they were learning to read it, and they believed just as was happening, you know, anywhere in America at the same point. But the therapeutic insurgents, there were no beliefs. They knew what was wrong, and they knew how to act, and they acted, and they did it, and, you know, and they knew magic, and they know magic is, you know, there's no need to get in the box about belief. It's just part of what happens for them. So if you take that back into, you know, the anti-vaxxers, that's why we need good ethnographies.
Yeah.
It's really why we need good ethnographies, because which part of it is them knowing, which part of them is believing, and then where are they learning those beliefs, if there is somehow, you know, an education, a textuality, and then kind of a creed that comes out. So it's a great question.
Yeah, it's a good point. It's like, I think Assad's thinking about the creed, where it's like, I believe this, I believe that, and that creed is a rejection of another, of allegiance to something else, right? Because then you became Christian and you're supposed to reject. And so that's really where we get with politics, is like maybe with democratic politics, we have this creedal conception of, you know, like I subscribe to this and so I'm not that. Whereas I think, you know, with Obia and with other things, there was a kind of pragmatic and eclectic approach where it's like, there was a willingness to use various different techniques and not to get in a creedal conception of belief where it's like, I'm a Christian, so I can't use, you know, Hindu deities or something, you know, like, I think that's a different approach that's more pragmatic and maybe
experimental,
that's
even.
Yeah, experimental, you know, and so maybe we need to use Chris Christie even if we don't like him or something, I don't know.
But like the guys who crashed into the Capitol, you know, which part of it was believing and which part of it was knowing and thinking? It was hybrids. It must have been thousands of hybrids. Mm-hmm. But I think there probably was, for a lot of them, you know, especially with more evangelical backgrounds, there was a big belief part.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, and we have a couple of...
Just one more point. You know, I'm not going to go into it, but I have this quote by Michael Polanyi in my paper, which where he, as a trained scientist, you know, chemist actually, talks about science as a vast system of belief, which... Uh-huh. Nonetheless, cannot let go of out of our free will because it's entrenched in our world. That's, you know, that's just one thing. Check that quote. I really found it quite striking.
Okay, great.
Okay, well, we have two more questions. I'm going to read them by Gabby Alvarez. What other words than practice can you use to replace belief? This is one, and the other by Gal Almore. Is it possible that a way of unifying competing discourses or rational systems, the introduction of new legitimizing institutions? Okay, a contemporary example of this might be the way certain podcasts and podcasters now enjoy a degree of trust from a broad swath of the population that has been lost by traditional newspapers and television news sources. So a way to bridge these two or multiple rationalities would be creating new institutions.
When I first went to the field in the Congo, I had Bourdieu in the head, and the idea was, my idea was, I'm not going to look for discursive consciousness. People, after a whole history of oral history, oral memory, everything, I'm not, it's not words I'm interested in. It's practical consciousness. Mm-hmm. What are people doing to organize childbirth? How does it happen? So, and that's where all the things came from. So it's, I mean, it's not, you, it's great to still have discourse. It's, you know, it's great to have the talking, the speech and all of that. It shouldn't be completely, and of course I collected some too, but the emphasis on practice, of course, Stephan would have things to say of what's happened to Bourdieu since in ethnographic field work and why he's old hat and stuff. But, you know, I don't, maybe that will help that question about what other than practice, doing, acting, that for me are the words that go together.
Well, no, I think practice is still very much on the agenda. And I've recently, you know, read a dissertation.
Frozen.
Oh.
Go ahead.
I recently read a dissertation where the author used the phrase knowing practice. And I kind of like that,
uh-huh.
I must say.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because, you know, praxis has
like mindfulness.
Mindful, yeah. Mindful agency, you know, something like that. I mean, where, because, you know, I mean, praxis, you know, the distinction between action and behavior, right? I mean, you know, Max Weber, you know, where, you know, accidentally bumping into somebody while you're trying to catch a train is different from tackling somebody at a football game, right? So in one sense, you have mindful practice. In the other hand, you have just, you know, behavior that is not necessarily meaningful or not socially meaningful. That is, it may acquire meaning because then you have to apologize and so on and so forth. But I think that's one way of maybe looking at things.
Interesting. Well, it's 1:33. I think we are past our bedtime, and we have to wrap this up. It was really a pleasure being with all of you. Thank you for agreeing to come and for not charging us anything, sharing with us your ideas, your energy, your passion, etc. I'm really, really thankful. I am thankful also with Courtney, who's not being introduced at all. She should be on the foreground, and at least in the podcast, she's introducing the podcast. But she is the engine behind this operation. She is, there you go.
hey, Courtney.
Yes, she's more than an assistant. She's she has the ideas and thoughtful insights and an intellectual in practice, just as we are. Next week there's nothing, but in 2 weeks we'll have the first student paper presented and pre-circulated. It's Alex Chaparro. His paper will be available to all of you in a week or so. And then we'll have the week before a podcast by one of the individuals who will come to referee his paper. I forgot her name, Miller. We'll be discussing her book, Republics of Knowledge, which is an alternative to Benedict Anderson's Invented Communities. I think Nicola Miller, professor of Latin American history at the University College London. I think her book is really, really impressive and powerful as an alternative to Benedict Anderson's Imagine Communities, and also in a conversation with this webinar on knowledge, what is knowledge and who gets to decide what knowledge is valued and important in the creation of political communities in the 19th century in Latin America. And she comes with striking alternative narratives about liberalism, about knowledge in the 19th century, in the creation of republics and nations, and Latin America comes on top. So I invite you to come to our discussion, listen to the podcast, and then that will be led by Alexander and me, with introductions by Courtney, and then the following week, the discussion of Alex's paper on Tocqueville, recession of Tocqueville in Latin America and recession of Tocqueville in United States vis-a-vis Latin America. And you'll have very, you'll be surprised by his arguments. And again, Latin America comes on top when it comes to creation of democratic republics in the 19th century. All right. So thank you for being around. Thank you for listening to our conversation. And thank you to all the panelists.
Thanks for the invitation.
It was good,
everyone.
Thanks.
I enjoyed this a lot. Okay,
bye-bye.
All right. Okay.